Hello, this is Dwight Norris of FishNetwork.com here for another in-home video. Now today I'm going to be talking about river fishing bait. Since I fish on a river, the Charles River, I should learn and know more about what kind of baits I can use at this river and any other river that I may go to or you may be going to as well. So one of the first questions I can think some people might think that aren't fishermen is, what is river fishing? Let's just keep this simple. River fishing is fishing in a river. Fishing in a river is different than fishing on a lake, and fishing on a man-made lake, and fishing in a swamp, or a bog, or a kettle pond, or anything else. It is a body of water. It may be moving or not moving, but these small changes actually matter. Now, I won't be going into those kind of things in this video. This video is about river fishing bait. So let's get to the first question, which is, what is the best bait when fishing on a river? And that would be my first selection here. Worms, the age-old favorite. Get those 1950s pictures and you'll see them with the bobbers and the gigantic worms. And they're out, everybody's fishing, everybody's catching. Fish are still stupid, they haven't learned, they're not knowledgeable, and they're easy to catch. You can say that they're still easy to catch today, but I think we all know that they actually learn over time. I'm not sure that they learn over generations, but the really old ones, those big lunkers that you've been like wanting to go like for, they're smart. And I had a previous video which I went through all of the body parts of a largemouth bass particularly and how they continue to grow over time, and such as the brain, all the sensory organs grow. They're better at doing everything the older they get. They're not just wise, they actually understand what's going on. They see better, they hear better, they feel better. They're smarter about eating. They're like, I'm gonna go up there and jump at this school of shad or whatever, like a crazy man, and hit every topwater lure I see. I'm gonna sit down here below like a shark and wait for the good juicy ones to fall right into my mouth. But that's what's gonna happen when all that craziness happens. So, you know, they are wise as well. So, this is the best bait. Now, there are different types of night crawlers. Well, there's night crawlers from different areas, like European and such. And you also have like red worms, which are sometimes used for composting, but they're still worms, they still work. They're a little smaller. I have some of those, and I have some night crawlers. What I used to use back when I was a kid was blood worms a lot, because I figured that if the worm was bleeding, which they never do if they're a night crawler, then the fish would find it easier. And that was probably true. From what I saw, it caught more. But here was the thing, when you're a kid, you don't have any money, and a blood worm costs about 3 to 4 times as much as a regular worm. And definitely more than the 5 or 6 worms I found in my yard today after the rainstorm. Now, I did a little research, because my son likes looking at animals and stuff, and we found out we have at least 4 different types of worm in our yard here in Massachusetts. Lob worms, there's a pale worm, there's a green worm, and some kind of striped thingy. But they were all different. Some were big, some had paddle tails. I was a little weirded out. I was like, wow, I thought there was just an earthworm. But the world's a bigger place than I thought it was. But hey, once it hits the water, the fish don't care. It's a worm. So that is the best bait to fish with on a river. So let's go over a couple more before I go into anything else. Yes, obviously you can see the names here. Live minnows. I started with this because it's one of the things that they actually sell in a bait shop pretty naturally. If you're here in the area, there are several bait shops to go to, but the closest I think for people that live in like the Boston suburbs, because there used to be a place not in Southie, but somewhere around there. I think it closed. I'm not sure. I haven't checked myself. But the closest one that I know of is the Arlington Bait Shop in Arlington, Massachusetts. They're pretty good. They have eels too, if you saltwater fish and everything else. But places like that, you can get yourself some minnows. But you want to stick to whatever your local forage is, your local bait fish. It might be a minnow, it might be a golden shiner. We actually have those up here, but I'm not sure how and what amounts they are, because we have smallmouth bass as well in the upper Charles, but I haven't heard of anybody catching those right lately. Hey, if you fished upper Charles anywhere past the word town, past Waltham and up, all the way to, I don't know where it goes, Middleboro. It goes out to 495. It's a long, long river. It goes past a couple lakes to do that. If you have caught any smallmouth bass lately between that stretch, please tell me, comment down below, and while you're down there, click the subscribe button, please. I really want to know if they're smallmouth bass, because I really want to catch some and then talk about them, because I've never caught one before. I used to live near a place that used to have them, but I couldn't catch them. I was just not good enough. But now, it's game on. What was I saying? Minnows. There are several types. Figure out what's local to your river, wherever you are, and see if there's a local dealer that you can get it from, because you need the bucket. Need the aerator, or you're just deciding just to grab it, go fishing, use all of them. Don't care if they croak the next day because they're not going to be alive, because you're going to catch a whole bunch of bass or whatever else is out there. But I would invest in a bucket and an aerator if you're going to constantly use these, not just like a thing of water like this. There might be a picture or something weird that pops up. When you look at Google Images, they try to be good, but there's some weird crap that shows up on here sometimes. Like, that doesn't look right. Anyway, this is a bucket. You can put an aerator in it. Next thing is pretty similar, live shad, which is another big bait fish for largemouth bass. Now, this is all across the United States. I think the more southern states have higher amounts of shad. But up here, obviously, I made videos on it. We have huge gizzard shads that aren't supposed to be here. And when it gets really cold, they croak. The unfortunate part is we don't have 20-pound bass to eat those things because they're huge. I mean, what? A foot long? Do I really want to use a foot long bait? Because the shad are about to eat the bass. At least the ones I've been catching. Well, for the most part, they don't usually grow that much because they don't live that long because they're constantly getting eaten. But up here, it's not happening. Maybe that's why they came, even though it's super cold. Whoa. Also, there's live herring. Now, here in Massachusetts on the Charles River, you're not allowed to harvest herring. Not totally sure exactly what that means. You can't, harvesting mean you can't try to catch them. Use one of those, the drop nets that you throw out, which is a really hard thing to learn. If you do want to catch your own bait, it's more of a saltwater thing. But if you do, learn the proper technique. I tried when I was younger in high school for many months, and the best I got was a 75% coverage area. It was always one or two things that I just couldn't get the complete circle. But anyway, you can't harvest them here. But in other places you can. I'm sure they're a good bait. They travel from down south up the shore. Right now they're hitting the Charles River, and the striped bass and probably the blues as well are following them. Now, it's raining here a lot, and I didn't go fishing today, so I wanted to make this video. But I'm gonna go out there again. I'm gonna keep going out there until somebody tells me, "Yo, dude, I saw a striper in Boston Harbor," or "I saw a striper in the Charles River." And if you see any splashing, now the last time I went there, all the birds, the seagulls, and the cormorants were just sitting there, kind of waiting. But once they started attacking stuff, I can rest assured that there may be a striper around. So that may be now, that may be in another week, but I'm gonna bring my plugs, and I'm gonna go out there, I'll put in my work, and maybe I'll get lucky. Maybe I'll catch a keeper. And then I'll have to go through the unsightly thing of trying to figure out how to get it home without stinking up my office place. Now, I said I would make a new system to do that, to do that, but I mean, I haven't actually come up with it. I have it in my head, and I've seen it online, something similar, but I haven't actually created the thing. It's basically a giant plastic bag with some form of a holder that's waterproof that can hold ice as well. And then it's insulated and it's covered, and it looks like something you might stick your fishing rod in if you're traveling. But that's if you catch a big one. If it's just big enough, you just get a plastic bag. Hopefully it's waterproof. Throw a little ice on there. Keep it upright. Throw it in the bag. Keep it cool so it doesn't, go bad or something. And, take it home when you're done. Or if you're bold, put it in that refrigerator and hope it doesn't stink up the thing. I really want to do that, but I'm not because I don't want to be that person. But if it's cool with you, or you got your own refrigerator in your own office, awesome. But otherwise, just stick it in a bag. Use some ice. Take it home. Hopefully, you went fishing at lunch, or at least after work, just after work, and then you don't have to worry about all that crap. But if you caught it in the morning, and then you have to go to work, that's gonna be a long day. Now, the best thing, particularly, I keep like thinking about that bass, but the number one bite really you can actually bite down south at the fish, i.e. largemouth bass and smallmouth bass will eat is crayfish. If there was a worm that was like a foot long, or a huge minnow or a shad or a herring, and then there was or even a shrimp or a crawfish, crayfish, whatever you call it, they will go after the crayfish 90% of the time. Why? It's the most nutritious and it has everything it needs. It's easy. All they do, smallmouth bass are really good at this. When it comes at it and it attacks it, they bite off the claws first. So they don't want to get hurt. And then after that, it's defenseless and they suck it up. They like the delicacies of a lobster as well as us New Englanders. As you see here, there's some size changes that happens over time. I've actually went to one of these places that actually have the crayfish picks, and they're pretty good. They're pretty good. They're like little lobsters. Eat the tail, and just pow, pow, like pop them. They're like popcorn chicken. Wouldn't mind eating them again, but it's really hard to find unless you're down south, like really far down. Okay, now shrimp is something that previously I never thought about because I don't live in the Gulf of Mexico, but apparently you can use shrimp anywhere. And I haven't really studied shrimp to see like where it exists. I always thought shrimp are in the Gulf of Mexico and or the Caribbean. And that was it. I'm like, oh, it must be a warm water thing. But I think they're everywhere. They're just about everywhere. And we have local fishermen catching just about everything on a shrimp. Not just a shrimp, but a cooked shrimp to make it look more red. I think that makes it look more alive, more vibrant, maybe more meaty. And the texture actually, I believe it hardens when you cook it. Therefore, it'll stay on the hook easier. You won't have them stealing them like they were down in Jupiter, Florida, when I had the shrimp on the wrong size hook. A guy gave me a hook that was one size too big, and I switched to a smaller hook and then caught every single bite after that. I was like, are you kidding me? One size difference on a hook? I go from not catching crap to catching every single bite I feel. Just goes to show you that those little changes when you're fishing can make all the difference. Especially when you don't know what you're doing. You're taking somebody else's advice. So if somebody says you need this size hook, get one smaller and get one bigger. just in case, because you know, everybody doesn't know everything, not even myself. I'm learning right now. Okay, what am I gonna do next? Trying to forget. What is the best bait for trout in rivers? It was one of the questions that came up a lot. And guess what? Salmon eggs. That's a big thing. But we all know fly fishermen are all good. So you're talking about nymph flies, the new ones, or even ones that are still growing. People try to copy those with the flies and make replicas of ones that are in their local area, like the caddis fly, I believe. I'm not a fly fisherman, so I've seen things. I've worked with some companies that do that kind of stuff, or make actual tools that they can use to make fly fishing flies, but I don't really know. So if you're a fly fisherman, please comment down below and school me on what it is to be a fly fisherman, because I want to try. I said I was going to try this year. Gotta buy the rod, but I also have to buy the boat, and there's plenty of things to buy. I'm not gonna run out of things to buy. I gotta buy all these baits. Gotta try everything. Want to try everything, but it's gonna take time, and I have to be patient. I want to learn, and then I want to educate. Maybe I'll help somebody out, like myself. Siberian shrimp salmon? These keywords are weird. Apparently, there are some Siberian salmon eggs that trout like to eat. Also, one weird thing, does fake bait work? When I saw this question, I was wondering, what do you mean fake bait? Fake bait. Is that a lure? I mean, you just call it a lure, right? What the hell is fake bait? Sounded dumb. Then I thought, could they mean bait that is made to look like real, like a real bait, not just like a lure that's supposed to be, enhanced? Sort of like an imitation crab that you can buy, imitation crab meat that you buy at the store is made to look like it, but it's actually fish and actually tastes like it too. Just a little bit. Just enough to make you like be happy you have it. Once you have it real crab, you'll know it's 100% different. So I looked into that and I found one thing, or a couple things. This is the natural gulp extruded nightcrawler bait. Now, as you can see, it looks like worms are in there. But when you open it up, it's like a goopy goo, like it's like a mold of a nightcrawler, and it stinks like an old nightcrawler that has lived way too long. But the problem is when you hook it, it's not like a tough thing. It kind of falls off. And I don't really like it. It's not good. But I do remember watching a video of a guy who had like six rods out, and he was, I'm not sure where he was fishing at, but he had them out, and he had three of these, the fake worms, then he had real worms. He lined them up. Like real worm, fake worm, real worm, fake worm, and did an experiment for like hours. And when he finished, it was an overwhelming win for the real thing. I'm talking like 90% of the time they went for the real worm, which means since they're right next to each other, they're not like this is over here and this is over here. It's like boom, 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 boom. The fish aren't dumb. They know what's real. They know what's not real. We can keep trying to fake them out and then obviously like spend more money than we would have just getting the real thing. What are we trying to trick ourselves into thinking we're using a lure? No. If you want to use a night crawler lure, get a plastic worm and learn to do your presentations and all the other techniques and environmental things you have to think about. And practice, practice, practice. That's how you get better at tricking a fish, because they're constantly getting smarter. So you have to get smarter as well and more skilled. Now, there are some other things here that are interesting. I was used to seeing this on the old shelves at Walmart and stuff back in the 90s when I used to run over to the fair because I didn't get my license there in the past. And they had all the fishing stuff. There was no Amazon and buying stuff online or anything. I went to Walmart and I looked at all the lures. I'm like, oh, like I felt like I was in Wonderland. What would I buy next? Oh, wait, I have like $4. I should have mowed more lawns. I wonder what's on sale, is what I would think. And then I see these weird things, these little nibbles of like floating eggs and like a paste for trout. I'm like, I don't even know what the hell trout is. There's no trout near me. There was, I just didn't know. But yeah, there's all kinds of fake baits as well. Berkeley makes a good amount of them. One last thing I thought about was carp bait, because there are plenty of carp fishermen on the Charles River, and I see a carp pretty much every damn time I go out there. They're sitting under those lily pads, like almost not moving, and half the time they're silver or they're gold, which looks pretty cool. But it looks like it might be one of those tanks where I see all the carp like floating around in somebody's yard. They have those little pools they put them in because they just won't die. And the ones in the river are huge. And I accidentally hooked one during one of my first videos with a beetle spinner, and I hooked it right in its back. I didn't notice until the end, and I was like, holy crap, this must be a 50-pound largemouth bass. So I'm going to default to me getting a world record before anything else. Nothing else is possible. It has to be a bass. So when he got close, I realized it was a carp, and I was like, oh, a carp. And I was like, oh, that's my first carp. That's cool. And then it promptly broke my line, and it got off. So I didn't really catch it, but I hooked one. I hooked it with a lure, snagged it in the back. Sorry, I'm sure it fell out over a period of time. But for carp bait, corn is the overall thing. That's all I've heard. That's all I've seen. If you look at the old graphics here, you'll see what is the most popular thing on Google. Corn, and vanilla. If you know anything about vanilla and carp and catfish, I believe there's a guy with a carp and catfish YouTube channel that lives down in Virginia, which is very close to where I grew up. Maybe he knows more about this. He's a carp guy. Also, there's put the corn in like the corn meal. So you have corn meal on the outside and actual corn on the inside. And carp like that, I guess. I haven't gone carp fishing. I've seen some people locally here, some people in Boston, on a particular stretch. So where's that stretch? Well, when I see them next, I'll talk to them and get some information for anybody who's watching on this channel and fishes for carp. Because I don't. I'd say that, oh, I'll do that in the future, but I don't really want to catch a carp. No, not really. I'd like to catch a catfish, though. Not a carp. I don't know. It just doesn't appeal to me for some reason. Weird. Maybe I just don't want to use corn. And I like to eat things. I like to eat fish. I don't want to eat a carp. So, wow. I guess this is all I wanted to say about, river fishing bait and the types you could use. If you know of any more river fishing baits that I've forgotten about, not lures, and not fake baits, like things that are alive or at least are predominantly eaten by a fish in a river. Yes, catfish will eat like chicken livers and gizzards and pretty much anything that's rotten and smells and stinks. I've done that before. Gone to the old grocery store, got that variety meat pack, at least ones with hard points. Put a big old, I don't know, 3, 4-aught hook on there, leave it out there, and then like just wait And there was one time I fell asleep and it dragged my whole fishing rod in. I actually watched it go into the darkness and I was like, ugh, because I was in high school and I didn't have money to be paying for no fishing rod again. Luckily, I know how to work hard and I found some money to get a new fishing rod, but that was not a good day for me. Don't fall asleep without a properly rigged rod. I just had it against a tree stick. Most people have it like, it has like a drill that drills into the ground and then the rod is in there, so at least if somebody pulls it, it just bends it really far, or they have a bell on it. Or if they're night fishing, they have that light, like you're fishing from a pier, you can't see, and you have that little glow stick on the end of the rod. You're wondering if you're getting a bite, but it's windy out there and it's craziness and you're tired. Oh wait, my glow stick is shaking. Got a bite. So I'll just end it here. Please go down below, write in comments if you have any comments about this, or please like, please subscribe, and please keep watching the show. If you're local, I'll be rolling along the Charles River Esplanade area mostly, and trying to see if there's any stripers. I'll actually be going further up, closer to the Boston Harbor, like that in between point. I know they pile up there, and if I see any splashy, I'm gonna be throwing my plugs there for as long as I can, and getting that done. Which means I need to ride my bike, because I need the bike to get there faster. And that's it. So, get out there and get fishing.